So we've got a viewer who has just made a comment saying that this concept of heaven and hell is part of the problem of conversions. They truly believe that they are being benevolent and saving people, that they convert into Christianity and so on.
In fact, this is true. This is one of the reasons why they are very keen to promote them. So they told me at one of these meetings, they said, Mr. Lakhani, we want to save you. The day of judgment is around the corner. We want to make sure you don't end up in the wrong place. Please listen to us. They were actually begging me to listen to them. I said, no, I don't agree with it, so I will not just subscribe to you just because you are so, you know, concerned about my safety. I understand it. I like you for that, but that's it. But the thing is, the negative part of heaven and hell is this. I'm not trusting, but it's nice to talk about it. It creates fanatics. Not only fanatics saying we convert you, it creates a fanatics who are prepared to kill themselves to end up in heaven. Isn't it a frightening scenario? One individual told me, Mr. Lakhani, these individuals, these little youngsters, if you prick them, they'll go, ouch! They are prepared to strap bombs and blow themselves up. He says, he told me, this is the wrong theology, surely. How can you end up in heaven by just blowing yourself up or killing other human beings? So this heaven and hell scenario can create fanatic fear in here and now. In fact, I told one of the major cardinals in the UK, I said, my friend, I've got one issue. This idea of offering infinite reward in heaven is creating hell on earth. Mm. How do you respond to that?
Mm.
Of course, he didn't respond.
So, we've just, in this conversation, we've just answered one question from Sarov, who was asking that is moksha obtained in one birth necessarily or needs reincarnation? So we've touched that topic. This is something that would happen over a number of...
Can I say, suppose you are that intense about moksha. Suppose one Christian lady asked, Mr. Lakhani, I don't believe in reincarnation, but my love for God or spirituality is so severe, can I not attain moksha straight away when I die? I say, yes. If you are that severe, that strongly attracted to the idea of attaining your destination, that will drive you. So you don't need to become a Hindu and be reborn. Even if you're a Christian, you say, I wish to attain this kind of grand prize, my true nature, in presence of this ultimate reality. I'm saying, my friend, if that fiery zeal is in you, you'll get it in one lifetime. You don't need to be reborn. Same with the Hindus. Suppose you are that dynamic and that severe about your process, you'll attain your destination very quickly.
Okay. Folks, so if you have just tuned in, you're watching a broadcast, which is a live Q&A session. We do this every Saturday at 2 o'clock UK time. And Jaybhai, the next question is from Rajendra Trivedi. He's asking, how do we protect our Swadharma when there are people in the world who consider that their path is the only path and it is the right path? So, should we shy away from confrontation or give them a non-violent yet robust response?
You already answered your question. Give them a non-violent, robust response. That's what your tradition will tell you. Not need to be equally violent towards them, but at the same time now, you see, this is a question that touches me because, this is what I've talked to Nishita before we started the program. I say, you've been sending out millions of WhatsApp on a daily basis, is entering India, we know for sure. And yet, somehow it's not stirring up our people well enough to stir up and say, let us do something about our tradition. The only way you can protect yourself, your tradition, is to make sure these wonderful ideas, a deeper vision of our tradition, is not external. We're not asking for anything. There's no gimmick being sold. There's no donation being asked for. It's simply a clear, structured vision of your tradition in a rational format suited to our modern times. Can you make sure this message enters the Indian subcontinent? If it doesn't enter, we are, talking to, we are hitting our head on a brick wall. Please help us. The only way this tradition can be protected, promoted, is to just, simple thing, just offer this very clear, structured, rational, contemporary vision of your tradition to our own people. Our own people are struggling. They are kind of wallowing in ignorance and wallowing in this superstitious way of life. And so, the Shani Devi is looking, oh, I must go pray to Shani. This is pure superstition. Grow out, my friend, grow up.
So I'd like to take a moment to welcome Shashank Chopra. We've got Bhim Upadhyay watching us from Kathmandu in Nepal. We've got Ravindra Patel, Sambi Reddy, Ashvir Singh, and a few others watching us on Facebook. So we got a question here from Bhim. Would you please differentiate between God, deity, Bhagwan, Ishwar, Atman, Brahman, Paramatma? We've got so many ways of
okay, look, rather than go through the whole list, You see, we have devised different, kind of titles to give, kind of polarized idea of spirituality. For example, the idea of Atman is our essential nature, not what we appear as, but our essential nature is spirit. Now, spirit is singular, not two spirits. You can't say, my Atman is different from Nishidvaya. Hmm. Atman is Atman, except he's expressing, and he's expressing that, like that. Same Atman. So, Atman, this is the deeper vision of Hinduism. So, Atman is, if you like, recognize that our underpinning is essentially spiritual and not what it appears to be. This external, the body, the mind, the intellect, the ego are externals. Underpinnings, things they're trying to shine out is the same thing. This is the way we polarize the idea of spirit, manifesting as an individual. Atman. The word Brahman says the ultimate reality manifesting in the whole of this creation, not just me, Nishidvaya, and this kind of individual, like that. The whole creation is nothing but expression of Brahman, expression of the spirit, manifesting in the whole creation, all these black holes, everything is nothing but Brahman, boom, visible. This is, if you like, definition of Brahman. Then we said, okay, this is still kind of highly philosophic, and there is no gods, etc. So please bring in Bhagwan and Ishwar and all that. So then we devised other titles to think of this ultimate reality as a personality. And here we got this distinction between Ishwar, Bhagwan, Sagun, Sakar, Brahman, etc. But the idea is this, we try and polarize the ultimate reality when he's got certain kind of, powerful strengths, we call it Bhagwan. It comes with six particular features. And we kind of give this kind of different definitions of idea of spirituality in a personalized form. But this is the easiest way I can give this kind of very elaborate way of explaining the different vocabulary we use.
It's very interesting. So I'd like to take a moment to welcome a few new other viewers. We've got Krishna Goswami watching us. We've got a few other viewers here on Facebook. We have one question from Shashank, and he's asking, this is something we have touched on before, but I think it keeps popping up and we should keep pressing on the same point every once in a while, just so that because there are new viewers who would be joining us. The question is this, please share your views on the Manusmriti. Has it been misinterpreted or is it in favor of the caste system?
Okay. Now, just as we go to the scripture of authority called the Vedas, books of knowledge regarding nature of reality. That is the philosophic heart and the scripture of authority of Hindus. That's why we say Vedas are the scripture of authority. And they're not just ancient scriptures. A modern rishi talking about spirituality from his first-hand experience is the modern Veda. So it's ongoing living tradition with modern Vedas and ancient Vedas. This is the scripture of authority. Then we have also a lot of shastras. They're called shastras, means prescription offered to a greater society to how to lead a religious life. These are called shastras. And these shastras come in different flavors, and some are law books. That means books that you kind of, offer some kind of prescription regarding how an individual should live with his parents, his children, how should the king rule the kingdom, etc. These are called, if you like, these are law books created over many thousands of years. There are loads of them. We don't have one. But the one that has really caught the attention of the Western academic and somehow they've been, shoved down our throat is the Manusmriti. Smriti means secondary scripture. Bluntly, it comes with a sell-by-date. At the beginning of the Smriti, they'll say, this is only suitable to in certain contexts during certain period. Full stop. It comes with a sell-by-date. Just like you get a milk which comes with a sell-by-date, the Smriti scripture comes with a sell-by-date. This is a prescription offered or the law books offered for a particular society in a particular period of time, but they come with a sell-by-date. The Manusmriti was one of the smritis that we had adopted in the Middle Ages. Very frank, don't be frightened of it. They go outsiders pushed it in and they kind of imposed their own ideas, etc. We had it, bluntly accepted. That's why we had all this idea of keeping the outcast out of our society. Even the shadow of an outcast falls on me, I must take a bath. And all this thing was Manusmriti. So we had this scripture. It's not something that some outsiders imposed on us. We had it. Please be, some people say, Mr. Lakhani, it's not ours. It's the outsiders who kind of diluted it. It was our particular law book we had adopted in the Middle Ages. Please, that's why we have all these horrendous examples of caste discrimination, which a lot of ancient and modern proponents stood up against. So we had this Manusmriti. Please be recognized. And yet when you look at the Manusmriti, it will make you shudder. It will talk about things that will make you think, is this really true? Did the Hindus actually subscribe to these ideas? Like the caste, hereditary, hierarchical caste system. And even the idea of women as secondary was in, people say, no, they say women are good. But the thing is, it says, look, I'll tell you, touch you. He said, when a young lady, a little girl, she's under the control of her father. She can't think for herself. Mm. The father dictates what she has to do. When she gets older, gets married, she's under the control of the husband. In this day and age, go and tell any woman. They'll throw the manuscript straight away in the fire. The second thing, then when they're elderly, they are under the control of the son, elder son. Now you see, straight away, it's denigrating women. So it's highly patriarchal, may have suited a particular period of time in ancient Indian history, but it is not suitable now, and we have moved away from it a long time ago. I'm telling you, I don't know anybody in London who has got Manusmriti in their house.
Hmm.
And yet the Western Academy says, Mr. Lakhani, Manusmriti is your law book and you must adopt it. I said, we don't have it. Why do you impose it on us? The reason is this, it shows Hinduism in a poor light. And because of that, the Western academics are so keen to rub it into our face and this is Manusmriti, this is your scripture, isn't it? So we say our sell-by date is gone, go up, grow up, get off. So it was there. Please don't be shy to say that we do adopt certain laws that we think are suitable at that particular time. They are no longer suitable. We kick them out. Manusmriti is outdated for about 500 years. So it's still there and we have forgotten about it. But these Western academics, the Indologists are not prepared to let us go. They keep rubbing it in my face and I keep whacking it back. And in one rude encounter, I said, look, Manusmriti is the excretion of Hinduism. We have thrown it away. We have moved away from our poo-poo. What, you want to sit on it? Sit on it. But don't give it to us. So be very rough on this, but be very honest about it. Don't say, oh, we never had it and other people diluted it. We had this horrendous hereditary hierarchical caste system imposed in the Manusmriti. The sell-by date has gone a long time ago.
Brilliant. So, we have a question from Tech Radical TV, who was talking about being an atheist Muslim. And now his question is, if he were to convert to Hinduism, what caste will he be given? Or does caste not even matter? Because he says, to him it doesn't, but politically and socially, caste does matter.
Look, I'll give you the easiest way. The Bhagavad Gita, the scripture of authority, this is how we define caste. You see the difference between Manusmriti and Bhagavad Gita. In chapter 18, they talk about Brahmin, definition of a Brahmin. That's the highest caste, okay? This is how it's defined by Krishna. You can see, you can just rub it in the face of anybody saying, what caste are you now? You converted to Hinduism. Just ask him to read chapter 18. He says, a person who is spiritually oriented, likes to think of higher things rather than worldly affairs. Higher things, higher aspiration, higher ideals, is spiritually oriented. He's content by nature. He's not chasing madly after this. I must have this goal, this, buy this car. He's not that kind of bothered. He's kind of laid back regarding worldly objectives. Second thing. The third thing, he's truthful by nature. Look, my friend, you're being very honest and truthful with us on this program. He's truthful by nature. If you got these three attributes, according to the Bhagavad Gita, you are a Brahmin. Now, Brahmin doesn't mean you're born in upper caste. Simply means he's a spiritually oriented individual, mm-hmm. pay him tribute. That is all Brahmin means. Pay tribute to a person who leads a spiritual life rather than a worldly life. So all these very rich people in India are doing this marriage ceremony, spending £1 million. I said they are worthless. They are Shudras. They are not really fit to be called an upper crust of the Hindu idea of Brahmin. Spiritually oriented people are Brahmins.
Okay.
First of all, my friend, we don't like to convert, eh? If you like the ideas that I'm presenting, adopt them, make them your own. You don't need to rubber stamp yourself and go around saying I'm Hindu. You don't need to. Take the ideas. That's where the potency of our tradition lies.
So, viewers, at this point in time, I'd like to throw Jay Bhai a question that he's not expecting. I call it a googly. And the question for today is, that Jay Bhai, there is zero chance that all of your firmly and dearly held beliefs are true. Zero chance. So how do you then decide which of your beliefs are most likely to be wrong and which are most liable to be true?
I'm very honest, very humble in this sense. I suspect a lot of things that I'm presenting are perhaps misguided. I'm being honest. I've not done percentage kind of graph, but it is very likely that a lot of things that I think are true are perhaps not that true. So I'm very humble. I'm not saying, I've got everything right and I'm only 99% right and 1% wrong. I don't know. I never sat down to do a chart. One of the days, Nishitha, you forced me to do a graph, a chart, saying this part suspect, okay, we let you go. I've not sat down to do this, but I'm very in true humble manner. I'm saying I'm just actually really a mouthpiece of Swami Vivekananda's teachings. So if I get things right, give all the credit to Vivekananda. if I get things wrong, it is me. Yoo-hoo! I take the full blame. So anything good that you hear from this lips, know for sure I've pinched it, plagiarized the English word, stolen it from this great master, modern master called Vivekananda. And any nonsense I've been, you know, spitting out, please ignore it. That's my own little contribution.
The reason I bring this up is because so many people do so many things in the impression that what they believe in is correct. So when we talk about conversion, when we talk about people doing terrorist attacks, whatever it may be, this because of a deeply held belief, and they think they're right, whereas obviously other people view it in different ways. So my challenge to you all would be to be open to questioning what you believe. Don't just believe what you believe because you've been brought up to believe that. Question it. And if it doesn't make sense to you, move away from it. But don't just rely on that as because that's what you believe in.
That's very mature, lovely advice, Nishitbhai. Wonderful. Just basically be self-observant, saying that, look, maybe this thing that I'm so sure about is perhaps not so right. So be less kind of about your own belief system and impose it on others. Leave it alone.
So Jaybhai, we're going to throw you another googly because
too much.
Today we've got a number of people asking this question. Somebody asks, why did God create humans? Somebody else is asking, what is my purpose in life? They're related questions. Why are we here?
Yes, this is, we have explored this, and again, it's nice to explore it. Again, this bothers everybody. What's the reason for this bother? It is in a way something within you trying, stirring up and saying, sort yourself out, my friend. Who the heck are you? What are you doing here? That is the central, the big question that all human beings face. You are a religious person or a secular person. We all want to see, what is the purpose of all this? Why? You know, suppose you're a secular person, want big house, big car, holidays, etc. What's it? It's all going to kind of get snuffed out, you know, it gets forgotten, lost. Even I put my rubber stamp on my name on this particular hole because I've donated money. What is it? It's just going to dust, crumble away. So what is all this about? And this is the big question. So whenever you get this stirring up saying, what is the purpose of life? What is this about? You are in a way showing that the underpinning to yourself is stirring up, trying to resolve this issue. This is saying sorting yourself out, my friend. And this is the whole enterprise of Dharma. Sorting ourselves out. Who are we? What is going on? This stirring up is very important. Will it produce a result? The result is as follows. The result is this. It will in a way ask you to dig deeper regarding who you truly are and what is the nature of this reality. And when the journey is that severe, that sincere and that disciplined, it will take you to the jackpot. It will give you the jackpot. You'll get a prize. The prize is this. This question that is bothering you, needling you, kind of, you know, sticking you on the side like a thorn, will suddenly take you to its destination. Well, this is the only good thing about this, such questions. It will needle you, it will push you into a corner, and until you say, I must sort myself out, what the heck is going on? And then you see the deeper dimension that you possess will become revealed to you. And when the deeper dimension is revealed to you, do you know what happens according to the great prophets? The question drops off.
Mm-hmm.
What is the purpose? Why this creation?
It doesn't matter anymore.
It just drops off. The right word is drops off. This is the reality. So you say this thing that was bothering me will push me into a corner where I resolve my human condition. And that resolution comes with the idea this question drop off. All these questions appear here. How can it be? Surely it's relevant. Even if you have kind of attained your destination, a lot of people are struggling here. So come on, give an answer. They say you sort yourself out, forget about others. They'll sort themselves in due course of time.
Brilliant.
Sorry, it seems like a cop-out, but this is the only way you can resolve these big questions. And this is the whole enterprise of Dharma, sorting ourselves out. Who are we? Big question. What is why? Why are we here? This is what the Upanishads address.
We've got Yakshit was making a comment. He's saying, how mystic is this? I just started watching your videos last week and had lots of questions. And today he just stumbled upon our live broadcast. So brilliant. Now, if you want to stumble again on some more of these videos, what you need to do is subscribe to the channel, but hit the bell icon so you can be notified of the next videos that we upload. And we do upload very regularly, at least a couple of times a week. So the next question is from Sudipto Chaudhary. I hope I got that name pronounced correctly. The question is, what are the sadhanas to raise one's awareness to its peak level? And how does one be a brahmacharya and practice it?
Okay. The four pathways, the main pathways, for example, the tools we require are vivek, Vairagya. The Vivek and Vairagya are the main tools. They're saying that you must be more discriminatory regarding how you interact with reality. Because most of us get caught up with some fashionable thing, fads, temporary fads. You heard about this guru arriving in London, let's go listen to him. It's a fad, temporary fad. So you cannot get caught up with this fad. So first thing is be discriminate between what is a resolution, which is long-term permanent resolution of a human condition. Be discerning. So this kind of temporary fads that you chase after, etc., put them on the sideline, push them aside. It's difficult, that's first thing. Second thing is, have dispassion regarding worldly objective. That kind of way pulls us down, including the idea of brahmacharya. We attract to other genders inbuilt in all of us, huge force. So you have to, in a way, be kind of disinterested, you know, try and have dispassion toward this kind of worldly objectives of material worldly requirement, including gender attraction. That's the role of brahmacharya. So this is the way, these are the two main tools that we prescribe. The other thing they say is perseverance, titiksha, all these things are kind of natural kind of requirements for making spiritual progress. This whole list of them. I just touched on Vivek and Vairagya today.
Brilliant. So we've got one of the viewers on Facebook asking about the fixed schedule for this broadcast. Let me just advise everybody again. So this broadcast is run live. It's usually run on a Saturday. It's run at 2 o'clock in the UK time. We recently had a switchover in the time when we went, the clocks changed here in UK and we lost an hour. So some people may have missed out the usual timings, but it's always 2 o'clock in UK time. So you can visit us every week and get more goodness from this conversations. So we are almost at the time where we have to wrap up. We are at 47 minutes into the broadcast. And I have one last question, which is, why is Krishna and Ram and so on, why are they depicted in a blue color?
Oh, a lot of interesting answers. And I've heard answers from some of the other gurus, but I'll give you my own. I'm not a guru, by the way, but I'll give you my answer. You see, in order for us to reflect to the idea, how do we relate to the idea of infinite? They're not just, they look finite. They're human figures, you know, with two arms and legs and all that. They're almost human. So how do we show they're not human, they're something super, not just ordinary human? And the way we did it is to say, how do we reflect the idea of infinite? Now, what's the easiest way? Think about it. The way we think of infinite, for example, is today sunny in London, you look up in the sky, it's blue sky, boom, all over, goes off forever and ever, infinite. That's what the earlier people thought, it doesn't, but goes on forever. So the best way of depicting the sky, which is infinite, is the color blue that hits us straight away. So we said, let us now, use this trick to say that Ram and Krishna, or Vishnu generally, is this kind of blue color, reflects the infinite. So in a way, it's a symbolic. I don't think they were blue colored people. By the way, the film Avatar has got this blue kind of blue colored people. Perhaps they adopted the idea from Hindus. I suspect they did, actually. So the idea of infinite, a caught up in a finite form, we say still want to give it this kind of infinite kind of edge. So we say color it blue. This is why Krishna and Ram and Vishnu are generally shown as blue in color to reflect their infinite character.
Brilliant. So we're going to bring this to a close. So, we are all born. We then grow up. Some lead, due to circumstances, fairly insignificant lives. Others may be existing but not really living. And there are a few who actually live larger than life and leave their mark in this world. And when we talk about Hinduism, one of the things that J-Pai normally stresses is that it is an experiential religion. If you do not experience it, you will not truly understand it. And with this, I'd like to close with a quote from Swami Vivekananda, which says that experience is the only teacher we have. We may talk and reason all our lives, but we shall not understand a word of truth.
Ooh, heavy going. You see, in fact, it's nice to close the whole session on this. The reason why religion are perhaps ignored is because they are not presented as an experiential enterprise. So it's a believe in this and things will sort themselves out when you die, etc., or be reborn in a good place, etc. This is not what we are on about. Saying, if there's something special about us, the reality, what is our true nature, let me come face to face with it. Now, here and now, not in the hereafter, in the heaven or when I'm reborn, here and now, quickly. This is the reason why the tradition we come from is such a very, very, very engaging enterprise. It makes religions experiential. My friend, don't believe a word of what I've said unless you touched a glimpse of this idea of what your true nature is. Experiential religion. That's the most swanubhuti. You must experience it for yourself.